This song says, no matter who you are, no matter where you go in your life, at some point you're gonna need somebody to stand by you. Oh yeah, oh my darling, stand by me. No matter who you are, no matter where you go in life, you gonna need somebody to stand by you. No matter how much money you got, all the friends you got, you gonna need somebody to stand by you.
When the night has come and the land is dark, and that moon is the only light we'll see. No, I won't be afraid. No, I won't shed one tear just as long as your people come and stand by me.
And darling, darling,
good morning, good morning. Good morning, yeah. My name is Ben Cameron. I'm from the Doris Duke Charitable Foundation, as you've already heard. And in the words of Joel Gray or Alan Cumming, depending on your generation, willkommen, bienvenue, welcome. Or for Madeline Kahn fans, willkommen, bienvenue, welcome, come on in. To the first ever Idea Lab, an eclectic mix of live and video presentations that is deliberately designed to do three things in our time together this morning. To explore new ways that artists are working from which funders can learn, to explore common themes that resonate across the artistic and funding divide, and to bring the conference theme, the new creative community, animatedly and robustly to life. Today and tomorrow, we're going to kick off our time together by meeting extraordinary artists, four today, each of whom is strictly, and I do mean strictly, limited to an 8-minute presentation. In my capacity as dominatrix of today's events, or bad boy with an I for those of you who prefer the masculine declension, I will be strictly enforcing the time limit and I will seek your help in doing so. Should an artist exceed her or his allotted time, you will see me slowly rise from this chair and slowly approach the podium, step by step, inch by inch. At which point I will ask your help when the artist completes the sentence in which she or he is engaged to join me in expressing our collective thanks for the presentation with a round of applause. Now, each of the presentations are going to be followed by short video presentations, deepening our experience even further with three additional artists joining us by technology. And for those of you really hungry for more, this session is followed by a series of salon sessions that you can choose to attend, where each of our presenters today will explore the themes of their discussion even more. So with all of that, let's begin. Our first artist, Favianna Rodriguez, is a transnational interdisciplinary artist and cultural organizer. Her art and collaborative projects explore migration, global politics, economic injustice, patriarchy, and interdependence. Ladies and gentlemen, here to launch our investigation of the intersection of art and social justice, a realm in which she believes that the artist is an essential component, please join me in welcoming Favianna Rodriguez.
Hi, everybody. Thank you so much. Art for me has really been a tool to be in charge of my own narrative, to reframe some of the stereotypical and racist messages that I've been inundated with, and really to be a critical thinker and to have a voice. I'll start a little bit with my story. My parents are both migrants from Peru. They migrated here in the late 1960s. And a really memorable year for me was in 1986 when Reagan legalized 3 million migrants through the last wave of immigration reform we had. That was 1986, over 25 years ago. And many years later, when I was a teenager, Clinton passed NAFTA. And that year also was the year that the border militarization began along the US-Mexico border. And also that year was the year that Governor Wilson in California introduced the first anti-migrant state-based piece of legislation. So migration and kind of anti-migration sentiment has been around pretty much my entire life and has really shaped the way that I view the world. Many people don't know that Governor Wilson actually was the grandfather of the contemporary anti-immigrant movement. What would follow would be state-by-state anti-immigrant-based legislation. And at the same time, globalization was giving us a really mixed message, which was that capital and the free market could freely move across borders, but people couldn't. And anti-immigrant really meant an anti-Latino message. I learned art thanks to free community art programs. And in 2001, I left the university to be an artist and to launch a web company. And around 2009, I co-founded Presente.org, which today is one of the largest online Latino organizations. And 3 years ago, I started Culture Strike. And Culture Strike was really meant to engage artists, writers, performers, comedians, filmmakers around immigration reform. Now, I want to talk a little bit about what exactly is the intersection between arts and social justice. So here on the left, we have the space of action, and on the right, we have the space of ideas. So let's think of action as where policy changes live. And often when we think of action, policies are things that are quantifiable. There are things where you can say a little bit of this, less of that. In immigration in particular, right now, there is an immigration bill being discussed in Congress today, and they're deciding, do we legalize this many migrants? Do we legalize 11 million? How much of this, how much of that? And yet, in the action space, policy is often only addressing a very small sliver of what is really at stake. And with immigration in particular, we are not even beginning to look at the root causes of migration, some of the foreign policy that's impacted migration. We are not looking at racial justice. A legalization is only one small piece. On the right, you have the space of ideas. Now, in the space of ideas is really where we can be visionary, where we do not have to be bounded by the limits of policy, and we can begin to imagine what a real, stable, and just world for migrants looks like. We can ask ourselves, well, what about the causes of root migration? Or what about the over 1,000 deportations a day that happen here in the United States? And so, really, I think that as artists engage in social justice, we need to be active in both the space of action and ideas, because often organizing and social justice has lived on the left and art has lived on the right, and the magical space is we can transverse the spectrum. So how are we making art that is shifting power, not just changing consciousness, but really shifting power, not just representing people of color or representing migrants, but really making it so that migrants are empowered, right? And I think that, you know, the magic space is in the ways in which we embrace both of them. And if you think about it, in the action space, this is the space of reform, right? And this is why we call it immigration reform. And even if you look at marriage equality is only one small part of what is really needed to achieve equity for queer folks in this country. And ideas is the space of revolution. And you need reform and you need revolution. And traditionally, the infrastructures that exist make it so that there's very little infrastructures for artists who want to engage in social justice to be able to freely move between actions and ideas. And so I'm going to start with a case study, which is the case study of Migration is Beautiful, a project that I'm involved in. And you know, Migration is Beautiful started as an idea, an understanding that the anti-migrant movement has successfully, over the last 20 years, created a culture where punitive and criminality is the norm. It's where we start the conversation. This is why deportations are at an all-time high in this country. They're over 1,000 deportations a day. At the same time, our movements, the social justice space, is constantly reacting. We're reacting to SB 1070 in Arizona, HB 56 in Alabama, the ban on undocumented students to attend universities. Migration is Beautiful was about reclaiming our dignity and the resilience of migrants and really framing migration as a positive thing. The monarch butterflies are beings that freely move from Mexico through the United States and Canada. And what would it be like if people could look at a butterfly and imagine the beauty of migrants, the resilience, the subversiveness, that no wall in the history of time has withstood the power of humanity, and that our human condition is to migrate. We've been migrating since the beginning of time. And also, what would it be like if we can uplift these stories and really create dignity as the norm? And the concept is actually not a new concept. It's a concept that's been used before. The Black is Beautiful campaign, which emerged in the 1960s, was something that happened very parallel to civil rights, which was that although we were there was a fight against segregation and for equality, we also needed to challenge the notion that blackness was ugly, right? We needed a way to say, no, we are beautiful, just like gay is good, which was inspired by Black is Beautiful. And this project, you know, took place in the streets. It took place through street art, to activities for children, where children could, especially children with parents in deportation proceedings or whose families had been impacted by separation due to deportations, could create their own butterflies and could have a conversation around how they believed their parents were resilient and their stories were really part of the fabric of the country. We launched a statement on immigration reform, and this was a statement to say the creative community cares about immigration. Signers included Robert Redford, Juno Diaz, The Roots, Pearl Jam, Russell Simmons. Here you have the artist sharing some of the imagery. Also to imagery that teachers could share. Here's the National Educators Association sharing images that say Dreamer is welcome, that they could put up in their classrooms across the country. And most recently, just 2 days ago, there was national marches in over 168 cities to demand immigration reform. And what they asked for is they said, we need the art in the hands of our movements. How do we create art where the youth and the families, the domestic workers, can create their own stencils? We created a how-to guide, and this is what it looked like in New York. Young people creating butterfly wings. We created everything from how to make a stencil to a wing to a rainbow that said LGBT rights are migrant rights. Here is New York. There is San Francisco. And this is Philadelphia, where they used the art just 2 days ago here to cover an ICE building, ICE Immigration and Customs Enforcement, and to show that we have to stop the deportations and keep families together. So to close it out, why is art different? Is because art can make that emotional connection to the viewer. Art is controversial, art is visionary, and art can push out our values. Thank you very much.
When I was first formulating ideas, I was listening to a piece on Radiolab, and it was about, there was this craze and period of time when people were going over Niagara Falls in a barrel, and it was such a big deal, and it was really about defying gravity and being a superhero in a certain way, and there was something that really resonated, and they used the term gravity heroes in the story, and that really sat with me, and to me it's that to make the choice to upset the ground underneath yourself is so rare and so heroic, because to actually make the choice to move toward a better way of life, even if you're going to give up all security and all sense of what's underneath your feet, you know, I find people that do that and do that by choice to be remarkable, and it's something I aspire to myself. I was wrapping my head around the idea that, you know, change usually happens in a major way because of something catastrophic. Like, you know, a person who's close to you dies, or you almost die, or drug overdose. The kind of things that kind of shock your system and make you look at life in a different way because you have no choice. But I was really looking at, well, but what about the times in life where you make change for other reasons? And the kind of heroic decision that is to embark on that, because it's no less traumatic, and in maybe some ways is more traumatic, because you are choosing to shake the ground underneath yourself and to get rid of what your security is, good or bad.
That was Trey McIntyre of Trey McIntyre Project in Boise, Idaho. And thank you to him for that presentation, as well as to Favianna. That was a fantastic start. Thank you so, so much. Byron Al Yang combines Western classical music, Chinese folk elements, and American musical theater with a penchant for the avant-garde. His interdisciplinary projects, scored for voices with Asian, European, and handmade instruments, have been performed in concert halls, festivals, theaters, museums, and site-specific locations around the world. Here to explore the implications of diverse rather than absolute aesthetics, please join me in welcoming Byron Al Yang.
Can I actually use the stand for this? Thanks. Good morning. Thanks, Ben, for the introduction, and thanks, Grantmakers in the Arts, for inviting me to come speak today. My name is Byron O. Yang. I'm a composer based in Seattle, which is a 21st century city, right, where the creative class is actually not artists such as myself, but technologists. Oftentimes, I go to events, and a lot of my friends and colleagues who started out in performance art or even in music composition are now working as music supervisors at Xbox or for Microsoft or for Amazon. And so when I go out and meet their friends, they're like, oh, you're a composer. What language do you program in? And I'm like, you know, what technology do you use to write your music? And I'm like, well, I use paper and pencil. The technology I use is about you know, a couple thousand years old. I'm a pretty old-fashioned person. I handwrite scores still. Maybe this is because of how I was taught. I was born in the early 70s, and so, you know, now oftentimes, you know, music organizations say you have to submit a computer-generated score. I'm like, oh, okay. But it may seem weird or odd that I'm, you know, invited to speak on the new creative communities when I'm actually using stuff that's very old, but hopefully in the old there will be some solutions. I don't know what they are, so maybe you can let me know what they are. This is a photo of my grandfather. Similar to Favianna, my parents immigrated here in the late 60s, thanks to the, in 1965, the United States reopened its doors to people from Asia. People may know of the 1882 Chinese Exclusion Act and the 1924 Asian Exclusion Act. And so both my parents came, and my parents were actually born to refugees on the Philippine Islands. So they're, both my parents' parents were from China, and they had fled in the late 30s, and they were born in the Philippines. In the 80s, one great thing that the Reagan administration did is they had family reunification. And so in high school, my grandparents, my paternal grandparents, came to live with us. And my grandfather, as you can see, is playing the piano. And you can see it's a Chinese household because there's plastic covering the furniture. But the thing is, you know, I was in high school, so I'm like, God, who is this old man? You know, like, because I had an upright piano and I was a composer, so, you know, I'd be doing my stuff. And then he would go and play the piano. It's like this jangy music. And I was like, oh no, what is that? And it's now that I, you know, live with incredible shame and regret that I never studied music with my grandfather. My grandfather, who actually both my paternal grandparents started the first Chinese school in Mindanao, in the southern Philippine Islands, They were teachers. Obviously, my grandfather played music, and yet I never learned from him. And so I feel like I've inherited a broken lineage, and I'm you know, I write these songs of dislocation to try and figure out what it means that my grandparents left, that I will never, that I'll always be nomadic, that, you know, I can never call China home, you know, and then I continually question if America is home, although I really like Seattle. So, you know, I continue to stay in Seattle. So what I did is I did this installation called Iju, which means to migrate. And it's songs of dislocation. And I imagine one thing that happened is my grandparents, their first son died. Their second son was 13 when they left China. And they left their daughter. And so another thing that happened is that their daughter, which they hadn't seen in over 40 years, was able to come to the United States as well. And by then, she had three kids. So as part of this, I started to imagine the music that would be made. For example, the lullabies that would be sung between my grandmother and her daughter. So that's just a little bit of that. It's there are water gongs, there's Chinese fiddle, there's string bass. It's a made-up language because my parents were emphatic about raising me English-speaking. It wasn't until they got divorced, when I was age 7, I was sent to Chicago to live with my father's eldest brother. My mom claimed that my dad had kidnapped me, and my dad was like, "You're a bad mom. He has to go live with them." And in Chicago, they actually put me in ESL because, you know, they didn't know what to do with me, and that's actually where I started to learn Hokkien. And then I was put in Hokkien is the language that my family speaks, and then Mandarin also, because I was forced to go to Chinese school, which I hated. You know, so a lot of this, I think, is about failure, the failure of me to learn from my grandparents, and the failure of my dad being in, you know, coming to this country, really wanting to be a professor, marrying someone who then he gets divorced from, and being, I was born in 71 at the end of the American War in Vietnam. He couldn't find a job, and he's been bankrupt twice. And so I read somewhere that, you know, it's the children of immigrants that are always trying to create maybe what is possible for their parents. And so there's this work called Stuck Elevator. I read about this guy, this Chinese food delivery man, who was stuck in the elevator in the Bronx for 81 hours. And he was from Fujian province, which is where my grandparents left. And I thought, wow, I could be him if my grandparents never left. So this is what some of the audience thought. Oh, thank you.
And period of time when people there was this app, and it was about to a piece on radio ideas. I was listening when I was first formulating.
It makes me really think a lot about as an immigrant doesn't speak English and stuff like that. It just like really touched me a lot.
It was an absolutely unbelievable production. We were just mesmerized the whole thing.
Leaving with a lot more wondering what to think and processing than a lot of other plays, which is awesome. Like, that's kind of cool.
I enjoy it very much. It's very well done.
The music was fantastic. What can I say?
So I'm going to close out. I have the 15-second sign. My father still hasn't seen the show. I really want him to see the show. It's been in San Francisco and New Haven. Hopefully it'll get to Seattle soon. I leave you with this, which is my next show. So hopefully in the next 4 years, you'll know what this image is. Thank you.
Oh. Well, I have been very fortunate to have grown up with both my maternal and paternal grandparents, and living with them exposed me so much to the idea of storytelling, and not just storytelling for entertainment or to occupy our times, but storytelling sometimes for disciplinary measures, because like when you do something wrong at home, my grandmother would sit you down in the evening in a dark corner and tell you this very scary story about how this boy who did that ended up being cooked in a pot by this ugly giant. And so the rest of the week you'd spend it visualizing this ugly giant and the potential. So anytime you'd be getting out of line, you'd remember this thing, visualize how it's going to cook you up and change. So I've been fortunate to take on that tradition of using visualizations, imagination, and telling stories to help shape direction and inform people's lives, just like mine was informed at a very early age. I am Philip Lisuata, and I am theater.
What you just saw is part of a video series on the TCG website called I Am Theater, if you're interested in seeing more such testimonials as Phillips was, and many thanks to him, as well as to Byron for his presentation. Those of you who are out there can't see, there's a gentleman here with a time card. It says 1 minute, then there's 15 seconds, and then there's the equivalent of a smiley button with the face going, which means like, get off the stage. And when I saw the smiley button, the frowny button, or whatever you call it, come up, I thought, wait a minute, let's just cancel the rest of the conference and let's do a giant story circle and keep going, you know, with Byron. That was fantastic. So, yeah, I hate that smiley button. Okay. Our third presenter today is Carin, an art historian by education and a curator and a critic by practice. She's currently the director of the Vera List Center for Art and Politics at the New School in New York. To expand and continue our exploration of the social justice and arts and how they work together, exploring the unique role of the arts in this work, please join me in welcoming Carin Kuoni.
Thank you very much. As Ben just mentioned, I'm a curator and art historian and not an artist, so I'm a little bit the odd wheel out in this wonderful presentation this morning. I'd like to thank you all very much for coming. I'd really like to thank Tomer Peterson for the invitation. It's thrilling to be here. No free improvisation from me, but 8 minutes on art and social justice. Let's begin. I've been asked to talk about this relationship between art and social justice, and following Favianna and Byron, let me state the very obvious. Art is of and in the world to an extent it has never been before. A significant part of it is participatory, articulates issues of broad social and political concern. Art is defined as entirely contingent on context and can be anything. Groups of people, conversations, the news, infrastructures, occupy. For my brief remarks, I hope I can squeeze them into 8 minutes, I'd like to propose two things. Rather than examine whether socially and politically engaged creative practices qualify as art with a capital A, let's begin with the assumption that they do, and first of all, look at how art might enhance other experiences, in particular as they relate to social justice. Secondly, let's examine what it means to not only think of these practices as art, good art, bad art, whatever art, but to call and to name it art. So here we go to the question of evaluations. There are numerous well-established ways to measure the social impact of creative work, usually applying either qualitative or quantitative criteria. Thanks to the fabulous work of Animating Democracy, we know that art, and I'm quoting from their website, changes awareness and knowledge, changes attitudes and motivation, changes behavior, participation, discourses, it changes systems, policies, and conditions. But there are specific aspects of social transformation that are instigated by art only, I would like to argue. Let's look at six examples. Several of them are linked to the Vera List Center, a public research lab on arts and how they relate to civic society at the New School in New York. For several days in 2007, In the heart of Midtown Manhattan at lunch hour, performance artist Sharon Hayes recited a love letter to an unknown person. The person who emerged as subject of the letter is a member of the US Armed Forces, a woman, quite possibly an American soldier in Iraq. It was part of a larger project entitled, I March in the Parade of Liberty, but as long as I love you, I am not free. Hayes speaks of the conflict between political and emotional commitment. Passersby stopped, they listened for a while, many chose not to stop. What Hayes had done was carve out a space, but more importantly, a time. The letter was memorized, spoken several times every lunch hour, fresh and yet reenacted again and again. My next example shows artist Jamie Cruz's work called Thingness of Energy, several interventions at the New School on the relationship between the time it takes to consume energy and the time span it has taken for energy to materialize. In a matter of hours, for instance, by heating a room, energy is consumed that has literally taken millions of years to form. For a few months, Cruz worked with experts on and off campus, scholars, students, maintenance workers, and the public, juxtaposing ancient fossil oil with newly sprouted fern, here it is, and facilitating short and long-term encounters between people and infrastructures, taking her flock from the bowels of the boiler room to the height of airy rooftops. The next image shows a public staged reading of transcripts from Guantanamo Bay Combatant Status Review Tribunal proceedings. This reading was held at Judd's Memorial Church in New York in 2007, part of an extensive project called Nine Scripts from a Nation at War, created over a year's time by Viralist Center Fellows. In this reading, the participants assumed the roles of a rotating cast of protagonists associated with the tribunals. There was the accused, there was a judge, a witness, transcribers, jury members, the journalist, interpreters, etc. The texts were transcripts of these tribunals that had occurred a year later and a different time and in a location far away from where this reading was happening. Next, we are looking at an art project called Vogology by Robert Sember, which consists of setting the conditions for a consideration of the terms under which an archive of the house ballroom scene, the voguing community, might be established. These conditions that Robert set up consisted of tightly structured conversations happening in public space and at the New School in indoors rooms, and each of them was choreographed by the artist. They have not yet led to any archive, but the speculation on the archive's potential is very real and congregates past, present, and future. In 2003, Slovak artist Katarina Seda returned to the small village of her childhood and asked people about what they were up to. Their response was invariably nothing. Seda set about to change that by simply synchronizing the timing of the most ordinary events, shopping, sweeping, cooking, or eating, and on the appointed day, for the very first time in this little hamlet near Brno, there was an actual workforce sweeping the streets together. For the very first time, there was a huge communal festive meal cooked by all at the same time, and there was a line to the grocery store that had never seen a line before. Adjusting time made invisible events visible and everyone's participation and complicity in them. My last slide refers to Dorchester Project, an extraordinary work by urban planner, musician, ceramicist, and artist Teatro Gates. Initiated in 2008, it involves the reconstitution of a number of buildings on Chicago's economically deprived South Side, but different from your standard urban renewal program, Dorchester Projects empowers the community through what the artist calls the politics of staying long-term and through objects, the material accumulation of history in archives integrated into the buildings and repurposed building material. All of these projects are participatory and meet the criteria for social impact. They have changed people's awareness and knowledge. They have changed attitudes, motivation, and discourses. What sets them apart from other social or community work is that they allow us to understand and think of time in new ways. And I think that is significant. Given that we experience non-stop simultaneities of various kinds and forms of knowledge and place, given that we live in a condition that could be called collapsed time of simultaneous presence, pasts, and futures, given that we organize and mobilize on various scales and at various rates of movement of or speed of change through electoral politics, interest groups, self-teaching, and self-learning, given all this, I argue that any transformation or social change initiated by art happens within such a rich variety of time frames. Accordingly, our evaluation criteria for the effects of art on in advancing social justice will have to begin to acknowledge time, and not in terms of the duration of impact of a certain artistic activity, but in terms of raising the complex quality of time, making that the issue and a topic. A situation that is introduced by forward-thinking artists such as the ones we've just heard, Byron and Favianna, but also about by the examples that we've seen. And to follow up on my second point, calling art art announces a situation that is distinct but not separate from the everyday, a condition of the possible for those to create a space for those dreams that Favianna mentioned. It opens a free, non-scripted, deeply personal, possibly irrational, multi-temporal space. This is the space where we can reflect on life as it happens today. So if we ask how art enhances social justice in ways that no other intervention can, we have to recognize that it does so partially by introducing new and necessary understandings of time, thus opening free, unscripted space, and that we can help this process if we commit to calling it art. Thank you very much.
Saying that we have enough artists is like saying we have enough scientists, we have enough designers, we have enough politicians. We have enough politicians. But,
fair to say.
You know, nobody gets to be you except you. Nobody has your point of view except you. Nobody gets to bring to the world the things that you get to bring to the world, uniquely get to bring to the world, except you. So saying there are enough writers out there, enough directors out there, enough people with points of view, well, yeah, there are, but none of them are you. And none of those people is going to make the art that you will make. None of them will change people and change the world in the way that you could change it.
As noted, that was Neil Gaiman, the novelist. For those of you who have not read his newest book, The Ocean at the End of the Lane, I highly recommend it. It's fantastic. That said, thank you to Carin, especially, for that evocation, not only of a lot of fantastic work, but the reminder of the role of art in redefining time and the conflation of time in a complex and my mind's sort of spinning way. So thank you. Thank you for that so much. Our fourth and final speaker of the day is Marshall Davis Jones, a poet who found his voice at the world-famous New Eurekans Poets Cafe. Marshall has participated in two TEDx conferences, and he regularly conducts spoken word workshops with youth and adults. You know, a lot of our time is about bridging. We're trying to bridge worlds of funder and artist. We're trying to bridge in a few minutes the moment of plenary versus breakout. We're really bridging the legacy of the past with the challenges of the future. And this gentleman, who is one of the great bridge builders in the arts and the social world of today, we are lucky to have with us, fresh off a red eye. Give me a special thanks and a hand to join me in welcoming Marshall Davis Jones.
All I have. So how do I express in 480 seconds how I got
here? Well, the short version is I got on the plane and took a train. Thank you very much. Goodbye. But we think about something as fragile as time. And at the end of it, we think all we want is to continue. And how do we do that? I think there are three things that we do as artists, as people, to continue. And the first thing is we hold space. Think about that for a moment, just the idea of holding space. When the actor comes out on stage and opens the curtain, they create this circle of energy. As a poet, I love words, so I think about the word circumstance. Our circumstances, and we take the word circum, which denotes circular, and stance, where we stand, our circumstances. We talk about being in the moment, being present in the moment. We're always present in the moment. It's impossible to not be present in the moment because we're always at the center of our circumstances. It's just the awareness that we have. So whether we are in the eye of the storm or staring in the eyes of our lover, we hold space. Whether we are the biblical Samson holding up the two pillars, or Atlas holding the world on his shoulders, or a woman holding a child in her womb, we hold space. I want to think about a movie for a moment that really changed my life and brought into perspective, again, how I got here. It's called Pacific Rim. I'm sure you've all seen it. It's a movie about giant robots and monsters. It's like if Godzilla and Transformers had a baby, and then that baby met Confucius because it was a girl baby, and they had a baby, you get Pacific Rim. And at the very beginning of this movie, the narrator says, "I always thought that aliens or our monsters would come from the sky." He said, "But we were wrong. They came from deep within the ocean. These monsters, these kaiju, I thought it was pretty fitting in life. Because we expect sometimes our monsters to come from out here, in this world. You know, when you have the dream and you have the thought bubble, right? It's like, do-do-do-do-do-do, here's the cloud. It represents the sky. But here are these creatures that come from deep within the ocean. And I think about our subconscious and how these monsters came up out of the ocean and affected everyone, the collective consciousness of what it meant to be human." And this is where I think the second part comes in telling stories. If at the beginning of our story, we realize that it is not from outside of us that the monsters and the creatures and the demons we fight come, but they are from deep within us. And it's the ones that we acknowledge from deep within us, the creatures, the adversity, the trials and tribulations, the things that challenge our very humanity as an individual. When we tap into those stories and acknowledge that we are at the beginning, at the helm of those stories, that is when those stories connect to other people, and hence we can continue. While watching this film, there was a scene where two pilots of a Jaeger, which is a giant robot, that they deduce that they have to control with two people. So two minds have to connect inside of a robot to make this robot work. And there's a scene where one of the characters is expressing to his partner that as they drift, as they come together across a neural bridge, to not follow or chase any memories, to stay focused and present in the moment. What happens is exactly the opposite. This character goes into a memory where she dives back into where she first encountered a kaiju, her own monster, her own demon. And while she's lost in that thought, she raises her hand to stop it from in front of her. Mind you, she's inside of this robot. And her arm controls the robot's arm. So in her mind, while she's focused on her own monsters,
She activates the laser in the robot's hand and inside of the infrastructure where everybody around will possibly die if that laser goes off. She becomes a threat to everyone around her, unbeknownst to herself, because she's lost in her own monster. Which is brings me to this. In September 2006, I walked from the Brooklyn end of the Brooklyn Bridge and stood in the middle. And as I stood in the middle, I thought about my own monsters and my own demons. And I got lost in my own thoughts. And those demons were tempting me to see that the water was the end and a great end to my life. Unbeknownst to me focusing on my own monsters that aren't real in this exact moment, but real in my mind enough for me to forget to just abandon any idea of anyone who could be hurt, any life that could be destroyed because of a decision that I'm about to make. Something tells me to finish crossing this bridge, just like this character had to finish crossing the neural bridge. And I stumbled from that point to the New Eureka Poets Cafe. I don't remember walking off of the bridge. What I do remember is seeing a beacon of light, walking inside, and being mesmerized by five poets, five artists who existed on the other side of this bridge. That allowed me to connect, allowed me to be a part of something much larger than myself. Just like this character had to cross the neural bridge to meet with her partner so that she can control something much larger than herself, to fight the monsters that were deep within that affected everyone, to hold the space that was for every human being on the planet. We all want to continue. We all want to continue. So I leave you with this. To continue the species, we make love. To continue the spirit, we make art. To continue, we make both. So hold spaces, tell stories, and build bridges. Thank you.
You know, those of us in the pre-conference for artists yesterday were talking about how sometimes we privilege words and how sometimes gesture is more important. So to Marshall, I want to say thank you for holding space, but going deep and going open for all of us. So thank you for that. There we have it, four extraordinary artists, complemented by three more to give you seven extraordinary performances, which is a rich feast to begin our day. And as a reminder, each of these artists will be conducting salons in the next breakout time that you can choose to go to. Tomorrow morning, in a comparable fashion, we're going to meet three more extraordinary performers with two more videos, which will give us a total of a dozen presentations by the end of our 2 days. But before we depart for our individual breakouts, it's my privilege to return the stage to someone whose coming has been foretold to you, but who you have yet to meet officially. If Janet Brown is the queen of GIA, as many of us think she is, and not just because of her extraordinary handbags, our next presenter combines in his own way the regal dignity of Prince Philip, the socially inappropriate behavior of Prince Harry, and the fashion sensibility of Kate Middleton. Please join me in welcoming GIA's own Tomer Peterson.
Boy, what a buildup just to give the housekeeping announcements. Thank you, Ben. So we move from here now to breakout sessions. And just so you, to help you find your way around here in this hotel, two of our breakout rooms are right on the other side of this wall, which you get to by going out the doors and back in. The rest in the next two sessions are on the third and fourth floor, and we're located here on a mysterious plane called the second floor mezzanine, which is kind of like Brigadoon. It comes and goes at different times of the day. But you get to those by going up, which you can do by going to elevators or a stairway that you'll find going down the hall this way and taking not the first turn to the left, which is the escalator, but go a little bit further. And there will be staff out there to guide you, particularly to the stairway, which is a little bit hidden. A couple other just quick announcements. We do have a wonderful film festival running late nights on your guest room television. In the program, it says it's on Channel 2, but it really is on Channel 20. That was organized by Vince Staley of Media Impact Funders. So we have a change of channel there for your note. And the last little note to give you is, if you requested a vegetarian or a vegan meal, you just need to identify that to your server, and they will bring you that option. If you're at a table and you think that the vegetarian next to you is getting a better lunch and you'd like to have one of those, well, you can't do that. No cheating. Because they're limited in number, and we order them for the people that requested them. So please help us out with that. And that's it. We're going to break now. We have two breakout sessions and reconvene here at lunchtime. Thank you.